Good morning, friends. Can I have your attention, please? We start the first session of this seminar, and the chairman for this session is Dr. Baldev Raj. Baldev Raj has spent 42 years in the Department of Atomic Energy. He is best known for his pioneering work and piloting work on India's prototype fast breeder reactor and the fast breeder reactor program. After moving out from the Department of Atomic Energy after an illustrious service, he joined an institution in Coimbatore where he continues. When Dr. Baldev Raj is not chasing neutrons or neutrons are not chasing him, he is going after robbers and pirates who steal Indian heritage, especially Chola bronzes. Some of his work on identifying and making signatures of our Chola heritage, especially the bronze heritage, is extremely well known. He also is, I saw his biodata, I don't know whether he has ever done any welding himself, but he is the president of the Welding Society. So with that little introduction, I hope he will be able to wed both science and communication, and I ask him to chair the first session.
We are delighted with the presence of Mr. Jairam Ramesh. We all know him as passionate technologist, communication, deeply rooted in society, and among us, maybe knowing the public the most. So it is very important that he is participating. We have very good speakers and 2 hours for 4 speeches. The purpose of this seminar is also to generate the pathways for future. All of us without discussion know that a country of 1.2 billion plus and aspiring to be providing a good quality of life to the citizens and be among the best in the world, the science communication is highly inadequate with respect to number, with respect to intensity. I would not say with respect to quality. We have some excellent people whom we'd hear, but we don't have quality in number. So that would also be one of the pathways as to how to generate the quality in the number. And communication is always embedded in the culture. You cannot take the models of communication from other countries and start communicating the science. So this has to be embedded in the culture, which is extremely important. And also, public is such a wide spectrum that how, and scientists are also a different spectrum of their achievements, of their capability to communicate. So communication, why it is a big issue is because the gaps are huge. And when gaps are huge, we all know whether it is generation gap or whether it is whatever you are doing, conduction of electron, when gaps are huge, we have problem. So that is why the communication becomes difficult. So one of the important bridging thing is also how do you make the public to understand the realities in totality in a very simple way. So we look forward to these speakers who have practiced this communication and who would tell us their experiences, and also I request them to tell us what we should do in the future. I request each speaker to take about 20 minutes so that we have 10 minutes for discussion. Then seminars like this, the discussion is extremely important. So may I invite Pallav Bhagla? I would not introduce any of the speakers because you have their short profile in the book and they are so well known to this audience, I don't want to repeat that. But those who want to know more about them, you do find in the abstract book. So may I invite Pallav Bhagla to...
Good morning, friends. First of all, deep appreciation for all the participants who found time to be here on what I consider a very important deliberation. For the conference, I approached 32 people to come. 29 people accepted the invitation. It gives me immense pleasure to see that this idea that there is a need to bridge the gap is an idea whose time has come. Before I start off, let me thank the National Institute of Advanced Studies, which welcomed me in as a visiting professor. I am a working journalist. To be here as part of an academic institution, it shows the large heart they have. I would like to thank Professor Ramamurthy, especially Rana Anindya Sinha, whom you heard in the morning. He didn't introduce himself. He is one of those rare people who found a new species of monkey in the country. Very, very, very rare. So he is a rare person. Binoy, who's worked with me tirelessly on this meeting, you would see him with energy all the time. He's a scientist. He studies fishes. What many don't know, that he is also a highly accomplished martial arts person, a super black belt in certain areas, but very gentle at heart. Hippu, another colleague who's not here, he welcomed Narendra Modi when he went to Bhutan. He's away to Sylvan, Bhutan. Mariama, where is she? She's not here maybe, but she's always there. Not seen, but always there. And I'm sure all of you must have received many, many very gentle, persuasive calls. She will still persuade people who have not submitted papers to please submit them. Remember, whatever is spoken is lost. Ink on paper is lasting value. I can see Prabir shaking his head. I am also a television man, Prabir. I understand exactly what you're saying. But at the same time, ink on paper is still lasting value. Mr. Aital, who did a wonderful job, so many other people at NIAS, I thank them from the bottom of my heart. I could devote my time to looking at the content of the conference, especially because of that. Thanks, Jairam, for finding the time for us. You are here not as a politician, as an engineer who's looked at these stuff. There are so many others in the audience. If I start thanking each one of them, my 20 minutes would disappear. I stand in front of you to speak about science communication in India yesterday, today, and tomorrow. I stand on the shoulders of many giants. Some of the giants are in the audience. It's not my calling to say that we are starting ab initio. It would be hazardous to say that. India has had a tradition of science communication. Professor Ramamurthy mentioned about it, which is started off with creating the scientific temper and removing superstitions. This picture is from the Kumbh Mela. You will hear more about that vast human congregation when Gauhar gives his presentation. I won't go into that. There have been laudable efforts in the past, just to name a few, and if I don't name all, please don't get offended. The National Council for Science, Technology, Communication done a good job. Two of the giants are here. Vigyan Prasar, in recent times, has done well. We shouldn't forget our public broadcasters, All India Radio and Doordarshan. And in recent times, some of the private broadcasters, especially my own channel, New Delhi Television, where I am the science editor, has done well. We had a magazine called Science Today in the past, which closed down. It changed its name to Science 2001, so it was doomed to go extinct at that point. It went extinct. The only surviving magazine in India is Science Reporter. The editor of the magazine who runs that is Javed Khan, is there with us, fighting a lone battle to keep alive, but yet keeping it ongoing. The copies were available on the stand outside. That was what happened in the past. As India moved around and moved forward, it went into a situation where communication was really, in my opinion, and these are my opinions, a one-way street. When it pushed the new green revolution technologies, we are talking of GMOs, and we see the resistance on GMOs. You talk to Norman Borlaug, I did speak to him, and he used to say, he's no longer with us, the Nobel laureate, the kind of resistance he faced in introducing the green revolution in India. Dr. Swaminathan also enunciates that. Subsequently, her whole resistance around the introduction of computers. Today, computers have become an omnipresent part of our country. I remember the time when I used to stand in a queue to get my railway reservation done. Oh my God, half a day, one day, and it would never happen. Today, you can do it on a mobile phone. Some of it is thanks to computers, but recall the days when there was resistance to introduction of computers. I'm sure Jairam would remember all of that very, very vividly. Today we have 800 million mobile phones in the country, more mobile phones than toilets, to take a phrase out of Jairam's phraseology, which now Modi is also borrowing. Which is fascinating when you see the political divide being bridged. That is why in this audience there is no political divide. This is not a political meeting. The new India needs a bridging of the gap. We need to bridge the gap between the scientists and the public. There is a need for a two-way communication between the audiences. Many of you will recognize this scientist is Dr. Mashelkar. And this person you may not recognize is a man who works from Assam, who makes everything out of bamboo, including a working cycle and a tooth. Imagine a whole tooth just made out of bamboo. He's showing his front teeth, which he has made out of bamboo, to a man who's done well in modern science. Old barriers are being shattered. Comfort zones are being broken. We have journalists in the audience, and all of us understand the kind of resistance and pressures we are all facing thanks to the disruptive new technologies which have come in. When comfort zones are broken, it also gives an opportunity for new avenues and challenges. For many in the audience who may not know or who may want, I have been a journalist for now 25 years, writing for the Science magazine since 1994, unbroken. I continue, even as I am visiting professor at science communication at NIAS, I continue my work with Science Magazine and with NDTV as the science editor. I have had a never-die attitude. I don't accept a no for anything. If I need information, I will go to any extent to get it. What you see is a picture of an interview which we did with Prime Minister Manmohan Singh when he was Prime Minister. That's Bruce Alberts, the President of the National Academy of Sciences, then Editor-in-Chief of the Science magazine, my Asia editor then, Richard Stone, and myself. We interviewed Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. This was an interview done in 2010, if I'm not wrong. This particular interview makes news even today. It was in this interview that Prime Minister Manmohan Singh said, forces in America and Scandinavia are affecting development thanks to the interference and funding of our NGOs. He said NGOs from their countries are interfering in our development. The new report by the Intelligence Bureau, in a way, had its genesis, and probably Prime Minister Manmohan Singh had seen that when he enunciated that to us. I decided to, while pursuing a career in science journalism, active science journalism, I turned 50 and decided there was a time for capacity building. I did not want to leave that till I was 60. I have gray hair, so I can't say when I become gray. But when I turned 50, I decided I needed to give time. For the last 3 years, I have been associated with the World Federation of Science Journalists. So in a way, what I will present to you as a possible way forward is what we have practiced as a World Federation of Science Journalists, which is a body of many, many science associations. Unfortunately, India is not represented because we don't have a representative body of science journalists. We have every 2 years a large meeting. Last one was in Helsinki. 800 journalists gathered. Only journalists speak to each other to understand their issues and take forward. A very large meeting. They've been wanting to have one in India. We don't have an association to take it forward. The budget for the last meeting was just 1 million euros. That's the kind of budget, and that's the kind of think tank which goes on in these meetings at the World Conference of Science Journalists. So whatever I'm doing is, in a way, what we have practiced on the global stage. I wanted to bring that for our own use, essentially from my experience of 20 years, where I have seen things sometimes going right, sometimes going wrong. So if there is a gap, how do you bridge it? There is a need for having a dialogue between the scientists and the academicians, and I don't distinguish scientists from academicians. They can be social scientists. And I firmly believe that if we can do it without the intermediaries, there is absolutely no need today for having an intermediary like me as a journalist for bridging the gap. Scientists can directly communicate to the public. There are outstanding ways of doing it. Whether it's necessary or not, I'm not sure, but communication can happen directly. Journalism will live because journalists have a certain role. We will continue digging dirt. We will keep digging in Jairam's backyard, what he did during his tenure as environment minister and why he took that decision on BT Brinjal or his decision on Jaitapur or whatever. We will keep digging that and pulling it out. But that's the role of the journalist. Communication is a little more. Further, what I will do for you is illustrate how this gap can be bridged, both for scientists, for communicators, and for others. Whenever you talk to scientists, they would say, journalists don't understand, communicators don't understand what we say. So scientists need to understand there is an intrinsic value in communication. And this intrinsic value is very, very important. Today, even the government is mandating it. The new board which has come up as an offshoot for funding is mandating that there be a summary of work which is available for lay people. Increasingly, private funding agencies are funding programs. The Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, got a large amount of money, several hundred crores. Obviously, that private agency will not give you money just for the sake of doing your research. They also want their pound of flesh. If people communicate, then it can also help get people more funding. It's a very straightforward link. But most importantly, it helps scientists refine their ideas. Very fundamental questions get asked by people who don't understand science. If Dr. Parthasarathy has to answer, what is the difference between a mobile phone radiation and a radiation which comes from Dr. Sri Kumar Banerjee's reactors, he is forced to answer in a language which doesn't include millisieverts and all the kind of jargon which people are used to using. I always tell scientists that there is a golden period. And fortunately in science, there is this wonderful period in which communication can happen. This golden period is between the acceptance of a paper and between to the final publication of the paper. There is always a gap. It is being reduced because of online publishing, but yet the mainline journals take the big ones that is still in paper. Use that time, I tell scientists, to reach me. When your paper is accepted, come to me, tell me. Increasingly, I'm seeing more and more scientists are doing that. Whenever I go and speak, and I have been speaking a lot in various institutions, people are doing that. For most scientists, what happens is, once a paper is accepted, there is a complete catharsis. Oh my God, finished, my work is done, now I can move on. So by the time the paper appears in print, they have moved on. And that happens mostly in India, not overseas. They need to understand that once a paper is being published, there is an opportunity to reach out. It's not bad to get mileage. People think it's bad. In India, sometimes we think getting front page news is bad. Many people feel if a paper is appearing in Science and Nature, it's under embargo, journalists will break the embargo. No good journalists, and you have two of them, very fine ones sitting here, Jayan and Padma. I can vouch for myself. In 25 years, I have never had to break an embargo. With the proviso that I will break every embargo if somebody's life has to be saved. That's the only proviso, and that's my editor's diktat. If you can save a life, don't need to stick to an embargo. But in 25 years, any scientific paper, I have never had to break an embargo. So these are very, very important fundamental things. This is a golden period. People need to reach out. Unfortunately, people don't. I distinguish between communicators and journalists. Journalists, people like me and people like Padma and Jen, we will do our jobs is to do our stories. We'll reach out wherever required. But what do communicators seek? All of us seek exactly timely and accurate information, quality information, and somebody who can explain stuff. We are not specialists in every area. And very, very often at very odd hours, early morning, late night, that's the time when you get time to start thinking about next day's stories, next week's stories. What are the simple things scientists can do for better outreach? I always say, a single A4 page written in layman's language is sufficient. And I don't think there is a need for now press releases. They should be outreach releases. You can do it for a very large community. Still photos, my God. Nobody ever thinks of photos, video footage, interviews, quotes, animation, infographics. These are all very powerful ways of communicating. Many, many times we forget that these are all necessary. If you have to hit the front page of a newspaper, I need a good picture. When we did the story on the sale of Bhabha's bungalow, I needed a picture of Homi Jahangir Bhabha inside Mehrangir. I don't want a picture of him strolling around in Princeton University. I need a picture of him inside. Pictures are so critical. Video footage, people just don't bother about this. TVV, Venkatesh, who runs our daily weekly program, both of us discussed, there's such a dearth of people understanding that there is a need for video coverage. It's 24/7, it's large number of channels. All of these are critical. As soon as the paper is accepted and people think that's high value, think of all of these. And please, when you go out and talk, tell people you need all of this. Engage with each other. What I'm told is scientists are inaccessible. If they are government scientists, they are constantly in meetings. If they are people who are in the private sector, there are a lot of private laboratories. They are forbidden to speak. And believe me, private agencies are far more strict about who can speak and who cannot compared to government agencies. And what do I hear from scientists? journalists are sloppy, they make mistakes, and they are invariably late for a meeting. Yes, some of us suffer from that, and that's because of pressures. And yes, I have tried to stick to my times and schedules, but I can't promise for everybody. But yes, our community does suffer from that. So the need is to engage. There is no doubt about that. And the engagement has to happen not when the paper is making controversy or news. It has to happen in peacetime. Peacetime not meaning war, but when things are quiet and things are happening. I would spend a lot of time with people in DRDO or people at the Department of Atomic Energy well before Kudankulam became controversial. So we understand what is happening there, to understand what is taking place. I was saying, make tools, 1 minute, sir, 2 minutes. Make use of modern tools, blogs, Facebook, Twitter, WhatsApp, Google+, YouTube. These are all modern tools freely available, cheap to use, very easy to use for communication. This is the blog which the Secretary of the Department of Biotechnology runs, Dr. Vijay Raghavan. Even as Secretary, he runs this. This is the Twitter page for ISRO. If ISRO can, why can't you? Unfortunately, today, ISRO is not represented here except with Sridhar Murthy and Kasturi Rangan, who came in the morning. Websites. This is the Indian Institute of Science website in Hindi. Yesterday, the government has mandated that all social media will also be in Hindi. You see, Indian Institute of Science website yesterday, it has a Hindi page. I always say, whenever you use social media, you have to exercise discretion. It cannot be. The usual rules apply. Use civil language. And if people don't comment on your post, don't get bothered. If people comment, be thick-skinned. I come to the last part of my talk, which is the need for an enabling environment, the kind of stuff which in the morning session many people spoke about. Heads of institution need skill building. I don't know how many heads of institutions have ever been trained how to face the press. Dr. Srikumar Banerjee, were you trained how to face the press? Or you faced the press for the first time when you had to? But training and skill building is required. Directors need to be trained. Researchers need simple training on how to communicate with the larger audience. And I always say students need to be exposed to media very, very early in their careers. They should not be afraid. Media is not something which will gnaw them. If you don't engage, all stakeholders need to engage. We saw what is happening, repeatedly mentioned about GM food. Clinical trials were not mentioned. Everybody, all of us have drugs. Should we have what kind of clinical trials? Politicians need bragging points. We saw what happened to the last government when it didn't communicate. And we see now what is happening to the new government and do not know where it is going when it is communicating probably a little too much. If communication doesn't happen, the public feels let down, and that's not a good idea. For some of you who may not have seen the manifesto of BJP, this is the 2014 manifesto of BJP, and in the manifesto, they categorically say, to promote science popularization schemes extensively. It's on page 35. You have next 5 years to hold them to do what they have said. And I've said, engagement is better than divorce. Today we are seeing a divorce happening between the two communities. And who better to convey than the scientists themselves and academicians themselves? If they don't communicate, what happens? Rumors fly faster. When Fukushima happened, rumors were flying faster, moving faster than radiation from Fukushima. I was repeatedly being asked, when is the radiation from Fukushima coming to India? And I would say, no, it's not coming. But people were very, very afraid and concerned. And why should scientists communicate? You hear them pining and crying all the time that we are not getting enough young blood. If that young blood has to come, you have to make it attractive, make it exciting. I want to make science communication exciting so that I can leave behind little Ramchandrans and Jayants and Padma and many more other communicators, Praveer Purkayasthas, who can do well in science communication. Skill building. Skill building is required for all. You have to make communicators welcome in the institutions, which is very difficult. Even at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, getting a camera in today is very difficult, even for me, even though I am extremely well connected and I can move myself in, but it's very difficult. Traditional journalism is under stress, and Jayan will speak about that. There's a need to hold workshops, both for journalists and for scientists. There's a need for a hands-on laboratory exercise. Get journalists to understand what DNA is, see what DNA is, extract DNA, look at it. There are a lot of younger journalists who would be very, very excited with that. Field visits. Kudankulam made so much news. Jayan is one of our senior most journalists. He has never had an opportunity to go to Kudankulam. Why should that be? Many more visits need to be organized by the Department of Atomic Energy for people to go into Kudankulam and see for themselves. A need for a media service like Eureka Alert should be done, a point which I'm sure Padma will emphasize. She does that in her paper. I'll wind up, sir. There is a need for an incubator which can catalyze some of this action. Some people called it the communication center, some people call it an incubator. I would rather call it an incubator, which can broker a middle ground, which can impart simple skills both to journalists and to communicators and to scientists. Meet the scientist events. It would be wonderful if I had seen many of our people who did GMO work to come and talk to the large public when the debate on BT Brinjal was happening. Celebrate both success and failures. And this was emphasized, we need to multiply in every language. And we need to multiply these incubators in state capitals. Scientists and public are really made for each other. I'm running out of time, I'm going to rush a little bit. And it's really not difficult. And today, when the trust is being lost, there is such a trust deficit. Winning back that trust is critical. There is a little tug of war happening. If Greenpeace is pushing the frontier at one end, you have the scientists trying to push the frontier at the other end. But by and large, in the battle for communication, in spite of the interjection by the Intelligence Bureau, believe me, Greenpeace would, in communication, play a stronger role, and that would be unfortunate. People just need to make an honest effort. It should be part of the endeavor. Science done in secret helps no one. It's a no-brainer, and that should be all. And to conclude, science communication is certainly not rocket science. I report a lot of rocket science. So people need to embrace change. Today, social media offers a wonderful opportunity to communicate to the large public. So my big message is just go out and do it. It's not difficult. Embrace communicators, and communicators will not fail the Indian public. The time is ripe for this idea. And it's important that this idea fructifies and goes ahead. And it's not as if we've not had efforts earlier. I acknowledge those efforts. But there's a need for a new energy. And that new energy could come from many places. We have many flowers blooming. We have the Science Media Center idea coming from the British Council and British High Commission. We have entrepreneurs like Sandhya and Sudhira who are pushing the frontier at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. We have individuals who are making a difference. Praveer is making a difference on the net. Each one needs to be bolstered and pushed. For an empowered democracy, all questions need to be answered, and communicators can certainly help in that. I stand in front of you feeling that In certain extent, I may have failed in communicating. If too many questions are asked, you can't blame just Dr. Paintel and others who have done GMO. Somewhere the communicators also need to face the brunt. Why does Rajendra Singh succeed and why do others fail is a question which should linger in our hearts and minds, since winning the hearts and minds is the most important thing in India now and forever. Thanks for your attention, and I appreciate the effort every one of you has made to come and participate in this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Pallav, for bringing your experiences and more important perspectives, the strengths and the deficiencies. The speech of Pallav Bagla is open for discussions and making observations. Yes, please.
आपने अपने प्रेजेंटेशन में कहा कि नई सरकार ने पेज नंबर
35 पर साइंस को कम्युनिकेट करने के लिए बड़ा वादा किया है. अभी तो एक महीना हो गया. तुम एक पत्रकार भी हो और तुम एक साइंटिस्ट भी हो. तुमने कभी सरकार से पूछा कि उनका प्लान क्या है, कैसे ये इसको कम्युनिकेट करेंगे? जब साइंटिस्ट बोलना शुरू करता है ना, तब समाज सुनता है. साइंटिस्ट बोलता ही नहीं है, बस उन्होंने जो भी कुछ मैनिफेस्टो में कहा है उसको तो तुमने बहुत अच्छे ढंग से हमारे सामने परोस दिया. बट यदि इसमें तुम इसको परोसने से पहले ये पूछते कि हमने नई सरकार से पूछा है कि इसको वो कैसे करेंगे, तो बहुत अच्छा लगता. थैंक यू.
मैंने कहा मैं पत्रकार हूं और मैं जरूर सवाल पूछूंगा. और मैं ये भी कह सकता हूं आपसे राजन भाई कि पहले दिन जब हमारे नए विज्ञान के मंत्री बने थे जितेंद्र सिंह, मैं उनसे पहले दिन भी मिला था और उसके बाद भी मिला था और इंटरव्यू भी किया था और उनसे पूछा भी था और उनको इस मीटिंग के लिए इन्वाइट भी किया था.
तो सवाल जरूर पूछेंगे, पुरानी सरकार हो या नई सरकार हो या आने वाली सरकार हो, सवाल उनसे हरदम पूछा जाएगा. आप उसके लिए चिंता बिल्कुल मत करिए.
सर, NCST, DST स्टार्टेड दीज साइंस कम्युनिकेशन कोर्सेज फ्रॉम 1988 और मदुरई कामराज यूनिवर्सिटी में कोर्स शुरू हुआ जो 4-5 साल के बाद बंद हो गया. उसके बाद PG डिप्लोमा कोर्सेज बहुत सारे शुरू हुए जो यंग साइंस कम्युनिकेटर की एक फौज लाने का इरादा था. अभी कुछ जगहों पे कोर्सेज चल रहे हैं किसी तरह से, लखनऊ, इंदौर और चेन्नई में यूनिवर्सिटीज़ में. इट इज़ फुल टाइम 2 ईयर MSc साइंस कम्युनिकेशन कोर्सेज और मास कम्युनिकेशन इन साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी कोर्सेज जो करीब 100-150 के करीब जो हमारे PG स्टूडेंट जनरेट कर रहे हैं. लेकिन सर कोई भी वैकेंसी नहीं है हमारे लैब्स में, हमारे सिस्टम में, जो इनको एब्जॉर्ब कर पाए. और ये बच्चे जो साइंस कम्युनिकेटर्स हैं, जो साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी को कम्युनिकेट करने के लिए पढ़ रहे हैं 2 साल, वो हमारे न्यूज़पेपर्स या मीडिया में किसी तरह से उनको जॉब मिलता है जहां वो पॉलिटिकल रिपोर्टिंग से लेके बहुत सारी चीज़ें करते हैं लेकिन साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी नहीं कर पाते. कभी साल में एक बार मार्स मिशन होता है या चंद्रयान होता है, मिशन होता है, तो ही कवर कुछ थोड़ा बहुत हो पाता है. अदरवाइज देयर इज नो. और हमारे मीडिया भी कॉस्ट कटिंग कर रहा है, उनको भी इतना नहीं है कि वो साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी को प्रमोट करे. तो हमारे गवर्नमेंट सेक्टर में, हमारे मिनिस्ट्रीज में, हमारे काउंसिल्स में ज़रूरत है साइंस कम्युनिकेटर्स की, जो अभी तक कहीं कोई ऐसी वैकेंसीज क्रिएट नहीं हुई हैं पिछले 15-20 सालों में. सर प्लीज, तो क्या
होनी चाहिए, होनी चाहिए,
क्या हम इसको अपने रोड मैप में रख के हम गवर्नमेंट को
राउंड टेबल, यू मस्ट, इट्स अ वेरी वेरी वाइटल पॉइंट. सच अ लार्ज, वी मस्ट हैव द अपॉर्चुनिटीज. इफ वी आर सेइंग दैट वी शुड अट्रैक्ट द टैलेंट एंड दैट शुड बी यूज्ड, इफ वी डोंट हैव द करियर पाथ्स.
अभी मोदी जी ने जो लैब टू लैंड की बात बोली है, अब उस लैब टू लैंड को, क्योंकि हमारे पास साइंटिस्ट कम्युनिकेटर है जो अपना पेपर कम्युनिकेट करता है रिसर्च पेपर में, बट हमारे पास साइंस कम्युनिकेटर नहीं है जो हमारा साइंस को मासेस में कम्युनिकेट करे, सिटीजंस में कम्युनिकेट करे.
I'd like to take forward the idea that was put in this slide about the Eureka alert kind of stuff. See, we have about 400 plus channels and a large number of radio stations, including private radio stations, and of course print media. I think we need to also look at establishing news feature service, given the fact that all the 400 channels plus radio stations are not going to appoint science specific correspondents, so they are not going to have internal capacity. So some kind of a collective effort to provide science news and feature service, both in video and audio plus print, might be an interesting way to look at enhancing presence of science in mass media.
You want to create competition from me, TVV. I would love to get into that competition. I would still want to be ahead and work hard. But yes, there is a need for a feature service, one something which can exist via YouTube, which people can use. So people can directly view, and whosoever wants to use can download and use. We saw in a wonderful way during the proteome paper which came out. They had video presentations available. They did a fine job. Wellcome Trust did a very fine job of that.
Anuj, a fantastic presentation and a nice opening talk, because I think, I mean, say that others will have now many things already open for them. I wanted you to also answer, what is the role of editors that you perceive, both with regard to the print medium and the electronic medium, and how can they be more positive? You only said about scientists and the journalists and the communicators.
This is a question which is asked to me many times. Editors are really the gatekeepers. And my simple answer to that question is, no good editor will overlook a story.
I wrote for the Indian Express. I restarted writing a few weeks ago. When I used to write, I would fight for space on the front page along with Hollywood, business, race, politics, all of them. Smart statements by people like Jairam. But yet, we would find space on the front page. A lot depends on the journalist, how you... Well, no editor will overlook a good story. Editors have a role, they will play a role, they have the big picture in front of them. But मैं कहता हूँ मेरी थाली है, उस थाली में मैं एक छोटा सा व्यंजन दे रहा हूँ, एक छोटा कटोरी दे रहा हूँ खाने की। वो बड़ी थाली में क्या खाना है, वो एडिटर डिसाइड करता है। उसको कहाँ से उठा के कहाँ रखना है, कब दिखाना है, वो उसका काम है। उससे मैं इंटरफेयर नहीं कर सकता। लेकिन मेरा काम है, जो मेरे सामने रखा गया है, उसको मैं ऐसा स्वादिष्ट बनाऊं कि वो एडिटर जरूर चले।
I must first thank Pallab Bagla for persuading me to come to this seminar. I hope his talk guarantees the respectability that I won't be able to provide. In fact, I feel an intruder in this seminar. I must explain my background. I'm an anthropologist. I work more on democracy. I work with dissenting imaginations. So if I make a few critical comments, please understand it's said with a great deal of respect to many of the people in this audience, some of whom I have seen as paradigms of what a democratic imagination could be. But let me begin by confronting the scientific establishment. Three wonderful scientists, unfortunately they're not present, but let's look at what they said. My old guru from IIT Kanpur, C.V. Seshadri, would say, science communication begins when the analyst is the case study. How do we look at the speech? Because I think they were a very convincing speech. Pity they're absent. I wish they were present, because I think to a certain extent, one has to see something. If you look at the way they spoke only of advanced technologies. There was not a word about social movements. In fact, if you look at it, the silence is amazing. In fact, what is even more amazing is one of them talked about the Dutch model of analyzing nanotechnology without understanding that the Dutch scientist who led that group actually came to India to actually understand how social movements work. V.B. Baker, my collaborator, in fact, acknowledges the Indian social movements in science and technology as background for the critique on nanotechnology. I think it's time we acknowledge the movements, what they've added to the imagination, the questions they've raised, because to a certain extent, otherwise we begin with corporates, with leading scientists, but we don't begin with the questions asked within democracy. If communication is about democracy, then we have to go beyond pedagogy, we have to go beyond popularization to answer political questions. They're unpleasant. But I think the problem with the way the word public is used so far is there's a politics of anxiety. I'm not yet including you, Jairam, in it. But there's a certain sense that the word public is always talked about in terms of resistance. The public is never seen as a way of presenting knowledge. The public is always seen as an obstructionist force. You can't create a positive democratic imagination with that. And I think it's very important, especially among scientists and science communicators who have been powerful storytellers, to understand the role of movements, the role of dissent, and I think what I already heard beautifully through yesterday's dinner and today, the role of storytellers like you in the art of communication. Because what we're talking about is not the old democracy, not the old clash between expert and citizen. I think we're talking about reinventing democracy. What can science and science communication add to the new imagination of democracy? And here, I want to just state a few principles. 20 minutes is enough to send you a telegram, so I'll make it a series of telegrams. Based on my conversation with two people, a dissenting scientist who walked out of IIT Kanpur to set up a small laboratory in Madras, C.V. Seshadri, and a woman who led probably the biggest trade union movement for women in the world, Ila Bhatt. I worked with these two people talking about science and technology. And it's out of these conversations that I want to first raise a set of principles. I must confess, I'm not as enamored with Modi as many of you in the audience. I spent 10 years investigating the genocide in Gujarat. And I think it'd be dishonest to say that because he's a prime minister, we can condone genocide. Let me be brutal about it. 10 years investigating me doesn't convince me that he has been condoned. And I think it's a part of communication to face to the truth of that. If it's unpleasant, so be it. You can erase me from your tapes. Let me begin just with a series of anecdotes and a set of principles. About 15 years ago, a group of tribal leaders from Gujarat came to me. At that time, I was actually innocently investigating BT Cotton before I got caught in investigating the Gujarat genocide. And they said, one of them was, some of these representatives I knew earlier because of my work as an anthropologist. They said, we have a request from you. Can you hold a seminar? I said, why do you need me for a seminar? He said, no, we want a different kind of seminar. We want a meeting between our tribal activists, our ojas, our medicine men, and the best of Indian science as Western science. And they said, don't talk to us about voice. Don't talk to us about you representing us. Allow us to have our own representation. And he said, the problem with science communication, or even with the structure of establishment science, is you people feel you can represent us, but we want concepts. We want our knowledge, our theory, to be represented in a scientific debate. That pluralism is not yet available in the idea of the public. They said, since you work in democratic theory and science, can you create a concept to counter the scientific temper? Beautiful concept. Many of you have used it heroically. But some others, bad communicators no doubt, use it as if it's a vaccine which gives you immunity against particular kinds of superstition. I'm a superstitious man. So we, as a part of the movements, invented the idea of cognitive justice. The right of marginal groups to their forms of knowledge, the ways of livelihood to their cosmology. Cognitive justice is the right of a people to their own form of knowledge, even if it is not officially scientific. And a democratic debate needs a battle of knowledge systems, needs a dialogue of knowledge systems, which movement groups have mediated. And I think what is missing here is, this is great talk of the scientific temper. Official, encouraging, Pallab put up a brave front on it, but there's no sense of cognitive justice. So the person at Kudamkulam, the person at the Narmada Dam, will always be treated as an objection, obstruction. She or he will never be treated as a scientist with her own worldview, with her own politics, and her own claim to democracy. The silence here is deafening. And I hope my friends in the movements will try to emphasize what I'm saying is not anti-science, but critical of a certain way of conducting and communicating science. Cognitive justice. The right of marginal people to their own form of knowledge, especially if their livelihood is anchored on it. Science as belief is okay, but knowledge as livelihood is fundamental to our democracy. Who talks of livelihoods? You people talk about nanotechnology. Fine. But let's talk about agriculture. Let's talk about craftsmanship. Let us talk of simpler ways of life which might actually have a complexity which can match nanotechnology and biotechnology. All these have to be a part of the spectrum of debate. Who's being represented? Advanced technologies? Leading corporations? What about the marginal in the village? What about the dying craftsman? What about movements which raise questions which are immediately seen as psychoanalytically problematic? Or anti-national, Greenpeace? Well, I'm also someone who's been called anti-national. But let me continue my act of sedition. The second thing I want to point out here is, I think you underestimate your power. I think I find it fascinating. This morning I was talking to Dr. Parthasarathy. Yesterday I was talking to people. There's a powerful imagination here. Science is a powerful imagination. Beautifully modernist, but there's some changes in science. I mean, let me do it in terms of three triangles. You originally began as a powerful Enlightenment discourse, which Gower and others have emphasized. Liberty, equality, fraternity. The ideals of the French Revolution, the ideals of Enlightenment, the ideals of the scientific temper. They meet to a certain extent the questions of the Industrial Revolution, which talk about productivity, growth, efficiency, and rationality. But today, the clash between these two systems has produced a third problematic: plurality, justice, sustainability. When is science going to talk about justice? Or is proof only the form of truth which gives you justice? Where is the talk of sustainability combined with justice? And who speaks for it? In what language? What dialects? Let me put it brutally. Science communication might be brilliant, but the scientific establishment needs a hearing aid to understand the dialects of resistance. Third point, quickly. This was raised to me by Ila Bhatt. He said, the trouble with you philosophers of science is you pretend you're only in the academia and the laboratory. She said, try to use the word epistemology in a wider sense. I remember the first time I tried to present the idea by saying that resistance groups, movements groups, are new kinds of epistemologies of knowledge and democracy, and the combination of knowledge and democracy. And I remember when I first presented it 10 years ago at Harvard, one of the World Bank experts got up and said, "Oh, Mr. President of World Bank doesn't understand the word epistemology." I said, precisely. Because epistemology is not a word within philosophy of science. It's not a laboratory concept. It is about linking life, livelihood, lifestyle, life chances, which many of the movements have tried to do. Epistemology has to have this wider sense of a democratic imagination, where knowledge and democracy combine in new ways to create new kinds of surprises. And I think it's this idea of a narrower epistemology of science, which I really want to challenge today. The job before science communication is to create this plurality of knowledge systems. Use the powerful media that you have got to talk about voices which have not been represented, to talk about knowledge systems which have so far been condemned facilely as superstition, and to talk about silences of people who have no place in stakeholdership because they've disappeared before the development project is over. Who represents the defeated? And I think it's a question science communicators have to ask. Because if your communication is an act of trusteeship, then that silence, that composedhood of defeat has to be understood and represented. Four, I like the idea of language and the multiplicity of language, which Pallab brought out brilliantly. But I think there's something more fundamental here. Translation. Like someone once told me, you know, the word corruption in English doesn't capture corruption in Urdu. In word like haq or dakshina don't quite mean the bribe. In the same way, I think scientific concepts need careful translation, not mechanical equivalences. In fact, I'm reminded of my friend M.E. Subbanna, who was a part of Hegudu, who once told me something fascinating. He said, truth to...
while commenting the science. Now, I'd like to submit, when we talk of science, science means facts. When we are communicating science through journalism or through other ways, it is conveying the various aspects of science and its effect on the masses. So we expect that the person who is doing so is not having any bias or any... But when we talk of the giving a political shape to it, there has to be some aim, some which is different than the real aim. So how do you bring them the two things together and justify?
I think that idea of the immaculate conception of science as value neutral dealing with science is a bit outdated. What I'm trying to say is you're political whether you want it or not. When you're discussing nuclear energy or biotechnology, you are political. You have to mediate between different groups and interests, which doesn't mean you are I'm paranoid or you are conspiratorial. You have to take into account these interests. Let me just take a simple example which looks innocent. The debate about Baba's house, even that is political. It can't be just said, oh, we want a memorial, because there's a politics of heritage to it. There's a politics of science. There's a politics of ownership. There's a politics of legality. And in a way, it demands that you mediate all, make a judgment, stand by that judgment, unless you defeated an argument. So I think there's, let me put it, politics has almost become an obvious fact. And it's not always dirty. It's a way of guaranteeing a different kind of imagination. And if I, in fact, talk to some of the older science people, whether it's Mr. Patsathi or Gohar, there's political present in what you're saying. And it's that part of the politics that guarantees to me the democratic nature of your communication and your professionalism. They don't contradict each other. So maybe here you and I can differ a bit. You want a strict professionalism, but I think this professionalism also requires a sense of citizenship, a sense of politics, some play of the democratic imagination, which science communicators are born. My favorite science communicator, Meghnad Saha. For 30 years, he ran science and culture in one of the most brilliant ways to make it one of the most powerful science and culture magazines anywhere in the world. Today, it's a rag. But I still remember the first times he created the idea of planning or talked about a society based on the scientific method or even his battles with Jawaharlal Nehru. That was science communication and debate at its best. He lost, but the imagination lives. And no one can doubt he was an outstanding scientist. But no one can also doubt he was an outstanding scientific communicator.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
Because being sitting in this chair again, whether I'm privileged to ask a question. Okay. Now, my question is that I do agree about your cognitive justice, that is a necessity for a dialogue of different knowledge systems. There's no doubt that on one side, as you just mentioned about, the science is representing only facts.
But when it comes to science for application in society, it is not just the facts. It is again you can call it technology, and it is definitely politics has a major role to play in that. There's no doubt on that. And when that happens, obviously, the knowledge systems, so knowledge of the tribals, knowledge of the livelihood, knowledge of all the people there, and also the scientists and the technologists who are implementing, and also the commerce part of it, all comes into, and that confluence finally makes it. But the problem that comes is, the second part which you mentioned about the combination of plurality, justice, and the sustainability. Now, what do you mean by sustainability? Sustainability, if you say, if we are, is a part of growth, a part of sustainability? Now, growth, I'm not talking of growth in sensex. I'm not talking in that crude terms. I'm talking of improving the quality of life of the human beings. Is it a part of sustainability? And if you want to do that, you have to sacrifice something somewhere. And it's a major point that is growth. Are we talking of a system where there's nothing like a growth? I mean, then, as Homo sapiens, perhaps we have continued as yet another species in this planet. So is that what we call sustainability? Or we need to have growth? See, I always talk of this, that humans, perhaps, I don't know how the anthropology of us will finally grow, that if you want to have a communication skill to a long distance, not like rabbits, our ear will grow, but we'll get a cell phone. So technology, I don't consider is something artificial. Technology is also part of human beings' growth in some way. There'll be conflict, and this conflict need to be addressed by what you mentioned about the dialogue of knowledge systems. And finally, of course, the winner will survive, like any other system. So, but I would say that technology should not be taken as, like we say, we are creating concrete jungles. The coral reefs are also some kind of a jungle created by corals. So it's a natural process. The way we are creating our concrete jungle is also part of human evolution. What's your take on that?
Yeah. I think the best way I can counterpose you is by citing the works of another biologist, Madhav Gadgil. If you look at his report on the Western Ghats, he raises the same questions, and he answers it in a different way. I mean, you can talk like a Montoya Kalavalia and talk only of growth. Some of the audience has suffered from that illiteracy. But I think the more important question to ask is, it's not growth versus non-growth. It's growth along with justice, growth along with certain kinds of representation. And to a certain extent, if you look at the Gadgil report, it does that classification. Does it in terms of a democratic imagination? The second question is, you say something some people will lose. Who decides? Who represents them? And this idea that only the victor should survive is something that doesn't add to my imagination of democracy. Let me go back to evolutionary history. If you have Darwin, though in fact the idea of survival of the fittest is a Huxleyan notion, the counterpoint actually comes from evolutionary theory, the work of Alfred Wallace. From Malay Archipelago to his work on the wonderful century, he gives a Kuhnian interpretation of evolutionary theory, a book which is ignored. And in one point he says, a science in its moment of victory must actually invent alternatives to make sure it does not get cognitively tyrannical. Wallace would be my paradigm of how to look at sustainability and diversity. So we're not talking, but the real question there is, who decides who's going to disappear? Or do the disappeared have voice? Or are they to be just left to a few activists as trustees of that memory?
मैं बस एक छोटा सा सवाल तुमसे पूछ रहा हूँ. तुम्हारे प्रेजेंटेशन में यदि कम्युनिटी का जो साइंटिफिक टेम्परा है और ये जो कमर्शियल साइंटिफिक टेम्परा है, इसका डिफरेंस यदि तुम अपने प्रेजेंटेशन में हमें बता पाते तो बहुत अच्छा लगता. थैंक यू.
मी और
हाँ यू.
ओ आई लव टू. हाँ बट आई डोंट नो, आई विल डू इट टेलीग्राफिकली, इट साउंड अनफेयर. आई थिंक टू अ सर्टेन एक्सटेंट द कमर्शियल साइंटिफिक टेम्पर also raises issues which have already been raised about the battle between public and private, about the wider democratization of the use of technology, the representation of technology. When we're talking about scientific temper in this broader sense, it can't be universalistic. It has to be pluralistic. It breaks down into many dialects. So one group can talk a particular language, another group can talk a particular language. It allows for translation. It allows for a multiplicity of words. I like the confusion of movements. If people call it anarchic, that's fine. I love it, and I enjoy its exploration. That is why I don't think there's one word, scientific temper, to be patented by anyone. That is my real answer to your question. Because even within science, I think they're dissenting imaginations. You know, almost 25 years back, when I was just finishing my PhD, Satish Dhawan brought me here to debate. He said, I wanted to meet a man called Amulya Reddy. My first debates were with Amulya Reddy. But Amulya himself was a dissenting scientist. And some of the things he said about nuclear energy weren't well received by audiences in this and other places in Bangalore. Dissent is also a part of that scientific temper. Defeat. The defeated also have a claim to scientific temper. They don't just disappear. They leave behind memories. They leave behind traces of forms of life which an Indian civilization has to protect. You can't dismiss it as progress.
Okay, I think we have to conclude the discussion here, but we'll have enough opportunity to continue later. So we'll go for the next one by Goha Raza.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm very happy and honored to be here because the results of Kumbh Mela survey, the recent one, have not been yet presented anywhere. So it'll be for the first time that I'll be presenting these results. And Pallav probably thought that I'm not good at talking about the politics and scientific temper, so he insisted that I should be presenting Kumbh Mela study results. I'll confine myself to that debate and not respond to whatever has been presented.
The provocations are the earlier speakers.
Yes. And I'm also very conscious of the fact, as a poet, you are always told that never recite your poem after a great poet has recited his. So I am at a disadvantage. Before beginning my presentation, let me take you back to 50s, where the world was shook because USSR, the United it suddenly puts Sputnik in space, and a country which was perceived and was known as lagging behind in both science and technology in the world suddenly wins the race, and that shook the capitalist world. And what followed was revamping of education system across the Europe and United States. It had its implications in India as well. But then they also realized that there is something called science communication to the public, which should be undertaken as a serious endeavor. And not only a large number of science museums cropped up all over Europe, but science communicators as a community also came into being. But by 80s, people started questioning efficacy of science communication itself. A lot of funds were put in. What has happened to this? Has it resulted into increase in what was called scientific literacy? And this is the period when John Miller and his crew started conducting large-scale surveys. It's not that surveys were not conducted before that, but a systematic study in the United States was launched. And Miller came up with the idea of scientific literacy. It existed, the phrase existed, but he gave it a new meaning. And then he started talking in terms of civic and cultural scientific literacy, etc., etc. But the major thing that he did was that he categorized people into scientifically literate and scientifically illiterate. And when we look at the reports, most of the reports on scientific literacy, this is the kind of bar chart that you see. This bar chart would have indicators here in this area. Then you have percentages, which will tell you how many people correctly answered the question. And then you have this area, which tells you that how many people did not answer a question correctly. Now for me, the problem was that this white area should have been probably painted by them as black, because this was the area of scientific literacy. They were more concerned about these percentages because they wanted to compare countries, whether more people are scientifically literate in United States or in China or in UK or France, etc., so that they can talk in terms of how good or bad science communicators are doing. More funding is probably required. That was their main objective. They were not really concerned about this area, so they did not look at it. Now in India, I was asking a different question because I came from a very different background. There are lots of friends sitting here who have committed sins together. I was a part of the science movement in the country. So I was more concerned about those who may not be categorized as scientifically literate by people like John Miller and others. So I was asking a question that can we use the same questionnaire for carrying out a survey, which has been used in the West. Most of the countries, including China, adopted the same questionnaire, lock, stock, and barrel. Then we asked the question, whom should we focus on? Those who give scientifically correct answers or those who give wrong answers, and therefore should be focus of science communicators. Then instead of categorizing the respondents or the people as scientifically literate or illiterate, can we categorize the responses themselves? Because if you know what kind of responses people are giving, then you can probably find out strategies to make them more scientific within quotes. Given the same demographic parameter, I'll go back to this one. You see that across questions, indicators that have been decided, the percentage of people who give correct answer to various questions varies. This was a problem. Most people will not find it a problem, and I'll not get into details because I have only 20 minutes, right? The question that whether we can categorize responses or not led us to four categories of responses. Scientifically correct responses, scientific but incorrect responses. Man born out of monkey is a scientific answer, but it is incorrect answer for us. Then there were responses which could be categorized as extra scientific and don't know. Don't know was an extremely important category for us because that represented the represented the cognitive gap within people's worldview. Now, this initial steps led us to a model which we started calling as cultural distance model. Scientific knowledge is generated in a domain which can be put at a distance from people's cultural cognitive structure. And this does not look down upon people's cultural cognitive structure. There is a distance, that's all. This distance is determined by demographic determinants such as age and educational stage, standard, etc., etc. We have 20 of them. But there were intrinsic factors that influence this distance. They are part of the nature of scientific information. Now, we could identify four major intrinsic parameters. Complexity, that is involved in explaining a scientific phenomena. control that individual or a collective of people can exercise over the phenomena, intensity of intervention in people's life and life cycle of a phenomena itself. Now, this distance could be measured or not, was the next question. So we came up with empirical method to determine this distance. Hurry up, time is running fast. Now we could define this relative cultural distance as the distance traveled by a scientific idea, a piece of information, law, etc., etc., on a scale, on a time scale, to become integral part of the worldview of the citizens. Empirically, we could draw the graph with dichotomous variable, where we could plotted scientifically valid answers and scientifically invalid answers, and they will always meet at 50. Don't ask me to explain that, but they will always, if it is dichotomous variable that you plot, they'll always meet at 50. So in this area, more than 50% people have accepted the scientific explanation of the phenomena. And in this area, it will always be less than 50% people in any cultural group or subgroup. Therefore, this much distance is traveled by the idea on this time scale to become part of at least 50% people's cognitive structure or worldview. Now, this point, which we call point of democratization of idea, moves on time scale for different indicators. The result was that we could plot a province like Kerala, and you could place shape of Earth as a concept and its scientific explanation at 0.5, minus 0.5 years, and then rotation of Earth at 3. And you see, one can plot these ideas. You can also do this exercise that put the idea in the center and then plot various cultural subgroups or states at a distance. Delhi happens to be at minus 2, whereas Maharashtra is 2.8. That is the cultural distance, empirical cultural distance. This is the result of analysis the past 12 years. This was the Kumbh Mela in 2001. This was the Kumbh Mela in 2013. We can report with confidence that cultural distance between these phenomena, explanation of these phenomena, has been reducing. That's a good news, probably for some of this, some of our science communicators. You can also find the shift that has been taking place over a period of time using a simple equation. Mean cultural distance, the shift has happened from 2001 to 2007, and between 2001 and 13, the shift could be plotted. And as the figures indicate, it has reduced substantially between 2001 and 2013. Now, how do channels of information react to cultural distance of a phenomena? On x-axis, we plotted cultural distance of various phenomena. On y-axis, the efficacy of a channel was plotted. We got a curve which is drooping curve. It's bell-shaped, but it's drooping curve. In this area, the efficacy increases, and then goes to a saturation point and then comes down and then takes a dip. This is the area which almost becomes opaque. A channel becomes opaque to communicate the idea Q7 and Q8. This is the window of opportunity. Ideas that are within this range can be communicated by this channel. Right? The level at which the curve starts is important for us. The width of the or the span of this opportunity window is important for us. And this area is fairly important. It shows that all kinds of scientific ideas cannot be communicated effectively through a channel of information. Having explained that, these are the results. If someone has access to all three channels, radio, newspaper, and television, then the communication is more efficacious in that area. The peaks are high here, the span is large, and the origin also is close to zero. These are the results of 2013. So the efficacy of media channel, all three put together, those who have access to all three channels, and this is normalized for literacy and education, it has increased. The peak has gone up, the span has increased during this period. We are probably at the unique situation in India, where print medium is expanding in the country, especially Hindi print medium is expanding. It's reaching out to more and more people. And its efficacy is highest among the three. The peak is high. The span is larger than the other two, and it has grown at a faster pace than any of the other two. Radio has almost taken over television as a medium of, as a channel of information, which means that all ideas that we try to communicate through television, they may not work. If they lie beyond the window of opportunity, they'll not work. We may feel very happy to communicate, bombard people with ideas, but they will not get communicated. Therefore, it's extremely important to plot and think about what should be communicated, which channel should be used, and how much the channel is going to respond to your efforts. Thank you very much. One more thing, which is very disturbing. The percentage of those who have given correct scientific explanation has increased. The percentage of those who have given extra scientific explanation has decreased. But the percentage of those who have said don't know has also increased, which is an extremely disturbing phenomenon. Because this is where the cognitive gap is getting created. Old explanations which are called superstitious, and my friend Shiv will say that don't talk about them as superstitions. They are going out of worldview of people. But new knowledge has not replaced them. Therefore, it can be filled in by anybody if we scientists or science communicators don't pitch in. There is a cognitive gap that is enlarging over a period of time. 25 years of data shows that. Thank you.
Yes, please, sir. First there and then. First you please cut. Okay. You please start and then here and then there. Yeah. Please.
Dr. Rasa, I was just curious to know, have you got any data on the internet as an emerging source of science news in India, and especially in the younger generation, because we have Pew Center study data in other countries, and it's a point I'll raise in my presentation tomorrow that we have absolutely no data on how the younger generation, who are all addicted to mobiles and smartphones, how are they accessing their science news?
Kumbh comes only after 12 years. So 12 years back, that was not the phenomena that you could observe or notice. Today, yes, it is important, and we don't have anything. Nothing. Yeah.
Sir, can you just explain how you chose the subjects of the study? Because one group came from Kerala, where the access to the knowledge is very high. At the same time, other states may not be like that. And you are pooling the whole data into one.
See, there are many weaknesses that I have not talked about just because of time constraint. It's good that you raised the question. There is no All India study that has been conducted by anybody. I have been asking NCSTC to support that kind of study. In Kumbh Mela, you get the best sample that you can get. And therefore, it is highly skewed sample that we get. But whatever information is available is there to analyze. Lots of weaknesses. One of the weaknesses is weakness of the language. How do you translate? So it becomes a problem that you get somebody who knows both the languages, English and Malayalam maybe. And we get 20 people, 30 people, which is not a good sum. You are absolutely right. There are very many weaknesses.
Newspapers being the most effective, your results show that newspapers have been given the still, even after all the literacy programs, given the literacy level and also the reach of newspapers, do you think the results are because of the sample you chose, because you chose only Kumbh Mela? Otherwise, radio has been in many studies found to be still a very effective method of communication. Are effective in reaching messages.
As I said, that it doesn't represent, with confidence one can't say it represents Indian reality. But it does indicate that the people that come there to Kumbh Mela are from almost all walks of life. It is heavily skewed in favor of Hindus. It is heavily skewed in favor of also Northern India. So, I don't know how much the results are going to be different from what we are presenting today if we do a proper stratified representative sample in the country. But I think the trends will remain the same. That is what I feel. Since there is no study, I can't say with 100% confidence. But the results are not going to be very different if you look at India. This is a cross-section which is represented as far as economic reality is concerned. It does reflect economic reality of India. As far as social reality is concerned, it does reflect that. Maybe here and there will be some difference, because there is always a difference between people who come during Ardha Kumbh Mela and Kumbh Mela. Kumbh Mela is much better representation you find in Kumbh Mela than Ardha Kumbh.
Okay, one more question.
Short question, please.
Yeah, very short. Did you have any questions? The scientific temper, as you found, was increasing. Did you have any questions as a feedback? What contributed to it, with whether it is so economic or it is science communication?
See, I think now we should graduate to doing a study on scientific temper. That is one. Two is that our
communication of science should also graduate to creation of scientific temper. Up till now, most of the communication that is being done is in transmitter model, where it is assumed that it's good to communicate science. It's public good. Since our constitution says we should communicate science, therefore, create scientific temper, therefore we should communicate science. What we haven't done is that the objective of all communication of science should lead to creation of scientific temper. And scientific temper's definition should be debated continually and revisited continuously.
But did a study give any feedback?
There is, we have certain questions on attitudes, but this was not a study on scientific temper.
Thank you, Gaur. I think you have brought science-based communication, which is extremely important. Culture embedded, science-based. I think this we do very little, and that's going to be very vital. Thank you very much. We go to the last talk in the session, Challenges of Communicating, given by ASK V.S. Sharma.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's very difficult to speak after Shiv Vishwanathan and then Gauhar Raja have already talked a lot about scientific literacy and what needs to be done, the definitions of this. So my next slide, well, of course, you will have to ignore, because that's how we all presume that we have started in science communication. Let me just introduce myself. There are two names here because I live two lives. One as a government official in a research institution, the other one as a private life with as a science communicator. And both usually go parallelly, sometimes they mingle, and when that happens when I get some conflict, okay? This is what, when I want to tell people that I am into science communication because it is a fundamental duty, okay, what has been enshrined in our constitution. But that's not the only reason. This is some statistics I just want to give, what to take on from what Gauhar has just said. We have a disconnect with the people with regard to science. Why that happens? He has said that we don't know is increasing. The proportion of I don't know for the scientific phenomenon is increasing. Why is that happening is the question we should be asking. And this is the statistics that I have for this. If you look at it, 2012, we had about 8 lakh students appearing for 10th standard students. Why I chose 10th standard students is that we are day in and day out drummed in the fact that, you know, the science communicators should aim at a knowledge level of 10th standard students. And I also, there are several programs which we have been associated where, you know, we are told that, you know, we have to inculcate scientific temper, scientific, you know, spirit of inquiry among the students. I beg to differ. It's not just among the students, even among ourselves also sometimes we'll have to try to inculcate these habits. So what happens is that every year in just Karnataka alone, we have roughly 50% of the 10th standard graduates, okay, those who pass 10th standard, get disconnected from science. They don't continue to read or know about science on their own. That is the thing, okay? And if we have to reach to these people, there is only one media that we can look at, and that is the mass media. There's no other way. And that's what I always concentrate on. And I've been a writer for the past 30 years, writing on science since my college days. And my inspiration didn't come from the Constitution, because I have not completely read the Constitution except for some of the fundamental duties and this, which we have learned. But what happened was we had a extremely influential science communicator whom we all remember even after his death 30 years ago, B.G.L. Swamy. He was an exceptional scientist, a fantastic literature, and I think his is the only book, a science book, a popular science book, which also got a Sahitya Academy Award. And that is the distinction. And we also had influential literature like Shivaram Karand. And these were the people who just, you know, influenced the generation in 1980s and 70s like us to get into science communication. So I started writing in Kannada, not that I don't know English, mainly because what I love to understand, I just wanted to communicate, talk to people around. I'm not a good speaker, but I can write. So that was one of the reasons why I took up writing. And like we said, this gives us another reason why we should communicate in regional languages. A lot of that. Okay. Reason is that most of the media have a far wider reach than the mainstream English media. And that is a fact. And this is from, okay, 2012, 2 years down the line, not much has changed. You can look at the last one, Rishi Prasad. It's a magazine, I hear, that being produced in Hindi. Basically, maybe a religious magazine. I have not read it. It has got the highest circulation and readership. Now, as science communicators, whom are we targeting? How are we reaching the people? I would love to speak to each and everyone under the sun. When that is not possible, I have to depend on some of these media, which is one of the, as a communicator, I have to do this. Which media should we select? This question was one I have always asked. And many of my colleagues say that, you know, we have to have a science magazine like Science Reporter or a science page in a magazine, newspaper and things like that. But I would even go to Rishi Prasad to communicate science. Why can't we do? Let me just give an example. We have a religious institution, JSS institutions in Mysore, which holds a conference of, rather, it's like a Kumbh Mela every year. And in that Kumbh Mela, there is a specifically, these days, for the past 4 or 5 years, they have started also organizing a science exhibition. So as a science communicator, I would like to use these opportunities also, not just in understanding the mechanisms of science, understanding public understanding of science, but also science communication, whether we can use these congregations. And I have used some of these kind of publications. For example, we have a Go Vishwa in Karnataka, published by a religious mutt. Though I am not so religious, what I do is, since that magazine focuses only on issues related to veterinary and these things, I pick up some of the interesting things on veterinary, this one, and publish in that. It has got its own clientele. Why can't we use that? These are some of the questions that I'm asking. I'm not going to the academics of science communication, whether we need or not. And some of the approaches that I have adopted here is what I'm saying. And regional language newspapers have the reach that we are looking at. This is in Bangalore, where we are studying and where we are right now. And the reach of two regional newspapers when compared to the English dailies are far different. And again, they look at the audience, see the target group that is between 35 up to 50 years of age, which is what we are looking at. Why we need it? I'm going fast a little bit. Okay. I was a fan of Abraham Kaur, and that's how I got into science communication. I tried his techniques also in, you know, telling people that about superstition and all, but I failed miserably because I come from a very orthodox family. But it doesn't mean that the superstitions or myths die down once we have the scientific literacy that we want. This is an example. It happened just immediately after Fukushima. And what happened at that time was most of the television media, especially in Karnataka, we have 8 of them, 24/7 channels. And I'll come to that, the structure of the media also, how it has changed over the years. And what happened was, they connected Fukushima with supermoon. And we have a daily dose of Jyotisha on our channels. And these Jyotishis, they said, let me just quote one of them. He said, you know, from the west coast up to Puttur, which is about 40 kilometers away from the west coast, you will have a huge flood. And what happened the next day was something we also have to remember, the influence of media, how it happens. The west coast has a lot of construction work going on, mining industry also is there. And from the northern Karnataka, a lot of migrant laborers come down here for temporary work. These people started going back because they fear for their lives, and they started going back. I could have kept quiet. What happened on 10th, that is 18th March, one of the newspapers called me and they said, sir, we want a story on this. People are simply going back. There is a heavy rush and all these things. So can you write something about the myth that this is not correct, that nothing will happen, things like that. I said, no, why should I write? So please ask, you are in Bangalore, you have a lot of people, especially who can, you know, astrophysicists are there, we have ISRO and all these things, why don't you contact them? They said, we tried to contact, but we couldn't get any response for this. So can you please help us? And this is at around 7 o'clock in the night, and they have to go to press at 8 or 10. Then I didn't know what to do. So what I did was simply I wrote a love letter to my wife, a public love letter. I said, supermoon is coming, why can't we go for a walk? We have missed the previous three supermoons, and let's go for a walk tomorrow night. This is the message I said. And this was published on the, and in the letter also spoke about what is supermoon, how it happens, all those things, but in a sort of a way that I speak to my wife. Of course, my wife never read that. That's a different thing. But next is, on the day of supermoon, at around, you may ask me what was the impact. At least there was one impact of this. I receive a call from my mother, old mother, or my sister, who is looking after my mother, that my mother has broken her arms. What happened was, she read the article. She was so thrilled, she wanted to see the supermoon. She went upstairs, and while coming down the stairs, she fell and broke her arm. So at least one impact I had this. I think both. She read that she is 80, 85 year old. She could read this, and she was very much interested in looking at the supermoon. And at the same time, I don't know what she felt after falling down and breaking her arm. Superstitions do happen. So we have a large public to address science to. And this is one of the things. It's not just a superstition. Anything that is related to science, if it is not conveyed properly, we will have a difficulty. So this is just a channels that we have available in Karnataka. We have more than 400 newspapers. The Mysore city itself has 60 newspapers, and we have added one more, 61 right now. And there are about 12 major newspapers. We have roughly around 20 channels, and 8 channels are 24-hour news, and we have 9 radio channels here. But what's happening? We have a bloom of this media, and if I think that I can reach everyone, that's not happening. That's the problem here. One of the problems that has happened in the media, especially in the print media, is the regional editions. So if I have a page for Mysore in Mysore, it reaches only the Mysore people, not anywhere. I have a problem here, not just in communicating news, which we are talking about. Even when I design a page, write a feature, I have this problem. It is published only in a regional edition. So we have to be extremely brilliant, like Pallav said, to take a very nice dish to the editor's table. So otherwise, if my dish is not so attractive or tasty, it doesn't happen. I have put ICT on the top because it encompasses almost all the media today. But still, let me just tell you that I have experimented with all sorts of media here. and all formats of science communication, including science fiction. I find it's very challenging. I started the first science blog in Kannada, and I was also the first one to close it down because there were not many takers. So I found that, you know, writing on the newspapers is much better to communicate to people. And when it comes to magazine, we had several magazines in Karnataka. Even now we have four science magazines to be precise, which are being published. But they have hardly a reach of, except for Bala Vigyana, which is being published by the Karnataka Rajya Vigyana Parishat with the funding from the government. The others don't even have a print run of 1,000 or 1,500, including the KSTS Vigyana Loka. So how are we going to communicate to the people? Who should communicate? Do it. I would prefer the scientists do it, because in my institute, I'm neither here nor there. My colleagues say that you are not a scientist, you cannot understand science because you are in information and publicity. And the media people say that you are a scientist, please talk to us because you are in an institution. So I'm neither here nor there. I'm a science communicator. So I would prefer that the scientists should speak to the public. Scientists should start writing. Whatever medium they use should be communicating about their thoughts, about their failures, about their findings and everything. But that doesn't happen. That doesn't happen. So somewhere science communicators come. NGOs are there. I don't want to speak. Journalists are there. Pallav Bagla is there. But in Karnataka, what happened was most of the science communication has been done by the teachers. And there is a danger in that, or rather what I see as a shortcoming in that is that the focus has been mainly for the children. So we think that science is only for the children, not for the others. Not for the others. This, I think, even, KCST is also here. Most of the programs designed by the four organizations that are in India, sorry, that are in Karnataka, the KRVP, the KSTA, the VGST, and the KCST, mainly target these kind of students. And I want to go beyond that and go to the public. The last one must be quite interesting for you, because we have talked about all these people doing this, communicating science, talking to people, trying to bridge the gap. I've been just asking a question whether we can have an evangelist of science. That's the thing. We have one in Karnataka already. There's one Professor M.R. Nagaraj. He speaks only science. He's wedded to science, wedded to chemistry. So what he does is he goes to a house, wherever it is, even if it is a birthday or even if it is a wedding, he will go and talk about science, only about science. What is science? And he's a wonderful orator. Mixes literature with science, speaks to that and all these things. But he's one of the kind. Can we have more evangelists who can talk about science, spread the message of science or this? You may disagree with me about this approach, but I think that is one of the things that we need. Do really people care if we talk about this? Are we just handing it down because we are forcing it them through their throat? This is a recent survey we did. We have started publishing a local newspaper in Mysore. Before we started publication, we did a survey and in six of the districts of Karnataka, and the results are there. The science and technology, there are 29, at least 20 to 30% of the people are still interested to read about science in science, you know, in a regular newspaper. And that cuts across all the age group. So we have a receptive group. The only thing is we have to find the doctors to give. So this is a magazine. This is a supplement that I'm bringing out. I must thank Professor Ram Rajshekaran, who gives me a free hand in doing any science communication work in Kannada, which is not very, you know, which is very rare among the scientific institutions. And that is something what Pallav Bagla was telling also. So this is a page that we bring out, and these two I have as an example. Some of you who can read Kannada can see that. This was about the proteome. When the results were published, yeah, one minute, sir. This is the last. So when we published, when Nature published this proteome story, so the very next day we wrote a news item, and then we called up Harsh Gupta, and he was driving. We forced him to, you know, stop the car somewhere, spoke to him for about half an hour, and then made this story, and it appeared very next day, immediately after that. What I'm saying is that if there is a will, definitely it can be done. The media here in Karnataka says that, you know, we don't get stories, as many stories as possible that are attractive to people. And secondly, they say that there are no writers who can write as well. So we are trying to put together a group of people. The other story is what we are looking at. Science communication in regional languages suffers from one thing, that is standardization of the language, what we call as, to remove the jargon and all these things, or we create new jargons in regional languages. So what I'm trying to do here is to speak in the same colloquial language that we speak in the parts of Mysore and Mandya. And the language is totally this. And we can communicate. We'll pick up only one particular subject, look at that, and then communicate in the same type of language that is spoken by those people. But still, we are only talking to the literates. For others, we have to go for the other media. And in Kannada, what we have done is about 4,000 books have been published, most of them on medicine or biology or agriculture. But in pure science, we have hardly any. And we have periodicals. I said we have four of them, but the total circulation doesn't even, you know, come up to 10,000. Then radio is the other media which we have used effectively with Vigyan Prasar. TV is there, he will tell you. But even here, the program is for about half an hour in a week. And that is another area. And I am looking at using the private channels, FM channels, to spread the message of science. This is another area, but they are looking at the marketing aspects, whether science can sell. And already I have put up a few ideas to them. I say that I'll give you the story, you get the sponsors. I'll suggest the sponsors also who can fund these kind of programs. So this is another area that we are looking at. Okay, movements, of course, NCSTC, Vigyan Prasar. These are the things we need to do in Kannada or any other regional language. Podcasts, Indian science on television, we have in English or Hindi, but can we please have it also in Kannada? That's one. Then lastly, games as a source of communication, as a medium of communication, computer games especially. Lastly, the blue one is the one which matters. Rest of the things we have. This is the best time I have seen, the best possible time where, you know, science communicators can be happy in doing things, except the aptitude. If we have that, probably this is the best time we have. Thank you.
Sir, how was the response of religious organizations when you approached them to popularize science?
Basically, I don't argue. What I do is, I use the science, use the images that appear in our Puranas or these things. So that satisfies them. Rest of the thing is science. So my faith is that if I have to push something down, sugarcoat it and push it down.
Sharma, it's a little unfair question to you, but how representative would the study from Karnataka and Kannada speaking be?
Basically, there has not been any formal studies anywhere.
Okay. We have, in all the universities, we have mass communication and journalism department. They have not looked at this, not even sociological studies on public understanding of science per se in Karnataka has happened. And we need to take it up.
It is somewhat revealing that one of your projections showed that more people read science and technology, 29%, compared to health. I was under the impression that health is more seen. Would it mean that the type of health stories that are coming in are not really popular?
Not exactly. What I feel is that the same group may also be interested in science. It's not that. What kind of stories would they like to have in a newspaper is the question we asked. And how many of them would like to study this is the analysis we did. And what happens is 29% of the audience do prefer science. And that's quite evident. That is why, see, this is a newspaper which is being published from Mysore and with a local circulation. We are bringing out two broadsheets of supplement every two pages, rather one sheet, every week for the past 7 weeks we have been doing and we are continuing. So while I am at it, the drawback is that we don't have writers. We don't have people who can contribute. So this is a forum I would request people to contribute in regional languages, whether it is Tamil, whether it is Kannada, or whether it is Hindi or anything. And with regard to this newspaper, we are also planning one more exercise. We are actually organizing some of the workshops for the people around in the university itself, for the students and all. And we want to bring them in batches, about 10, 15, and train them for half an hour or 1 hour, and then continuously monitor them for a year, bring them back to this. It's a sort of a selling exercise, at the same time, a capacity building exercise, which we want to take it up.
This is a problem in translation that obviously you face, but I would like to understand how you tackle it. See, the pace and the track in which science has moved and the pace in which language has moved are completely different. So you have terms, you have concepts which are very much English. So how do you deal with those concepts and those terms in translation?
Okay.
For example, DNA also.
DNA can be DNA.
Yeah, that's what, then it is a literal translation.
Yeah, but the concept has to be defined somewhere. Concept has to be defined. So this is the principle we follow. Okay. Mm-hmm. Incidentally, I also take up training of translators under the National Technology, Translation Mission, especially for Kannada. So where this, we have a series of programs where we try to identify the different things. You see, one of the problem with the science is that neologism. Neologism is we start creating new words every time. So how many of these are new concepts and how many of these are only repeats of old concepts is what we have to, as science communicators, identify. Once we do that, it is easy to filter out and use only the new ones.
How do you identify the new words? It's like with whose expert you identify the new words?
Yeah, of course. With let me just give you an example, okay? Let's say we have an embryo, right? We have equivalent words in Kannada or in any other language. When we talk about morula, which is a stage in development of an embryo, we don't have a word. So we call it as a morula, okay? It's an object. And when we talk about morulation, a process, then I don't create a new jargon. So this is how we go about. The next thing is, you may ask me, what do you say for gene, genomics, then you have lipidomics, you have proteomics, all these things. We call proteome as proteome, and the proteomics, we make it as a study of proteome. So there is a freedom for us. So we create as little new words as possible. But wherever it is important, we do that.
Income Trust DBT, which is a funding agency,
So we fund for research. So we get a lot of applications where, you know, we have a specific question in the application, what are your public engagement plans? And very surprisingly, it is answered as not applicable. Okay, so I think that I'm going back to the, still at a lower level of discussion where, why do we need to do a public engagement itself is not understood at a scientific level, even though they are very good scientists performing outstanding science. And I really don't know whether the institutes does a lot, a specific time for them out of their research work to get engaged into a public activity. Are they seriously looked at their appraisal, annual appraisals? How many public engagement events have you done? What have you conveyed to the society regarding your research? So if that is not a part of their institutional policy at all, they will be very busy with publishing papers and getting, promotions, because that is how they're evaluated every year. I mean, Dr. Binoy is here, who also is a scientist, and from ICER, Milind is here. So what can we do anything about it? I mean, it's a very lot of questions I ask. I mean, maybe we can take it after for a discussion or something.
I'm not competent to answer that. Professor Ramamurthy is here, and people who have been in the policy circles, they should be able to answer. But anyway, the thing is, in India, what I find is that even among the institutes where I am associated, the science communicator or the public information officer has the lowest esteem. Okay, of this. In this of the system, okay, and in most cases, he or she is the person who is not wanted anywhere else, and that is what is happening. Not because most of them are not there, not because they are competent or they are committed or they are want to do science communication, but because of that, I may be an exception.
I'd like to say that you should not generalize. It varies from organization to organization, but it is very fact a lot has to be done. Now, if you say institute-wise, very few institutes would come up with that. But we should spread this. So I'd have to close it because the time has run out. So I felt very honored to chair this session. We had very good takeaways from speakers. They also made some specific recommendations. And I think by the time we go to roundtable, through our teas, lunches, and interactions, pathways are not difficult to identify because the people who spoke, they spoke with conviction. We can take that, whatever they say. But mechanisms to implement those pathways and how we are going to proceed on those pathways, to convert pathways to topologies and destinations, I think that is where most of the time our difficulties lie. I hope by the time we reach towards the end, we'll have some concrete plans. Thank you very much for your engagement. Thank you for this.